So, hello everybody. I hope you are still awake. That's the last session for today. My name is Markus Kalkbrenner, and I'm together with Nick Wenhoff, and we will talk a little bit about the current state of Search API Solr and Solr Multilingual for Drupal 8. Very short introduction about Search API. Why do we need Search API for Drupal 8? If you have a look at this website at Amazon, where I search for some books, we can think of how to build that with Drupal. And if you have a look at the details of this website, you might decide that these books are entities in Drupal, having several properties. And you can display them in a view. But there are some parts of the page that the core doesn't provide for you. For sure, the keywords I searched for, the facets that are used to drill down the search results or to categorize the search results. We have filters to limit the entities by their properties, and we have different kinds of sorts. So this is my simplified definition of Search API. It's useful to build views of your entities and add additional features, advanced features like keywords, facets, filters, and sorts. In fact, Search API offers some more things. As you can guess from the name, it provides an API that allows you to build more modules that leverage search. Facets, for example, is a separate module. Autocomplete suggestions for text inputs. And out of the box, it comes with a database backend that stores the entities in a way that is optimized for this use case. In Search API, this backend is swappable. And that's the point where we start to talk about Solr. Solr is a replacement for the database backend for Search API. And the advantage will be that you get a higher performance, a better scalability. Solr itself has a lot of good features built in that are stable for years. And if you want to do that with the database backend only, then you have to re-implement a lot of these features in PHP. And that's something we could avoid. Additionally, we have a lot of multilingual capabilities built in Solr, and features like spell checking, content recommendation, and a lot more. Now I have to hand over to Nick. It will take a while.
Like this, right? Okay. So, hey. So who's still working with Drupal 7? 6? 5? No. 6? Yes. So I suppose most of you have installed Apache Solr. Who has? And Search API? Same people. That's confusing, no? OK. So I'm quite sure you know that there's some history behind all of this. I don't know if most of you know why in Drupal 8 there's only one. Who doesn't? or who's afraid or scared. Oh, where's Apache Solr? So in Drupal 7, we had these two competing products. One kind of had the ideology that once you install it, you should be ready. The other had the ideology that once you install it, you still have to click everything together, but you can actually do whatever you want. So it was kind of a different ecosystem for Drupal 8. We decided to merge that and to get actually best of both worlds. But the differences in Drupal 7 was that Apache Solr had a bit more of these multilingual extensions, but also it wanted to be multi-site capable, as in you could index Drupal 6 and 7 in one Solr index, and you could search them from within Drupal 7. That wasn't possible in Search API. But for Drupal 8, that will be, and I'll discuss that now. So this is us. Maybe one of them is you. Yeah. We joined forces, and we started in 2013. That's if you count back 3 years ago. That's a long time. So here you can see the progress of this merge of Apache Solr and Search API, and obviously the porting towards Drupal 8. Is there a beep for you as well, or just is it because this is here? Okay. So you can see that in July 2013, we started in Drupal Dev Days in Szeged. There's a whole lot of commits that happened there, like 300 commits. Ooh, something happened. The cable is wonky. But then in DrupalCon Amsterdam, there were like fewer commits because the process was a bit more regulated. But obviously, the amount of code that got added was bigger. And you can see there is this little dot sponsored sprint in Belgium and Switzerland, the right one. That's where we did like maybe 20 commits to Solr, and then nothing anymore after, because it was like so difficult to get these two merged. So we first focused on the database. And then you can see there's some funded by Acquia Lightning. That's where Facets got created. So we had Search API, Search API DB, Facets, but not Solr. There was like one company that had Solr in production. But in 2014, I would never have recommended you to do that by yourself. So moving on, so you see February 2016, that's where Marcus really got started. Think so.
So, like Nick already pointed out, while we had a good progress in the other modules in the Search API ecosystem, Solr just somehow worked, and if we look at the code, how it looked like at the end of 2015, the code looked quick and dirty. Some parts were outdated, weren't updated with the development of Search API and Drupal 8 core, of course. We didn't support the newer Solr versions that were available in numbers 5 and 6, and we had no dedicated maintainer for the Solr backend. Just a few people committed some patches to keep working with it, but it was not that good maintained. I think that changed over the last half year, the state we reached today is that most parts of the codes are revised now, improved, work better. There are still some parts that need to be cleaned, but I say all the essential stuff is working for searches. A big milestone or a good milestone was that we now have a common test base in Search API that runs on all available backends. All available backends, in fact, the database and the Solr backend. We have a test environment built on Travis, which always tests for Solr 4, 5, and 6 in combination with various PHP versions. And we have a synchronized release cycle. So started with the last release. And for the upcoming releases, if you get the releases from the same date, they should work together. As I pointed out, we have the essential stuff working, so there's still some things to do. In the Fuse integration, we still miss some fields that are available in Solr, but not in the database backend. That's essentially the multi-site search feature Nick already talked about. The autocomplete and the suggestion functionality is currently turned off because it needs some more test coverage and refactoring. The same is true for the more like this feature. And we face the situation that there are multiple service providers at the moment that offer a Solr instance installed somewhere on various servers. But none of them allows the full communication to all the available API of a Solr server. So we have to refactor that a little to get that pluggable for the various service providers. Yeah, and now I will talk a little bit about something else. It's the multilingual Solr search. And from my point of view, the really difference between the database backend, if you not talk about performance, it's a feature you won't get if you just run the database backend. To demonstrate what could happen, I searched on Google Image Search for a German word. It's Kuchenwagen. In English, it's cake trolley, and as you can see on the images, they really exist, this kind of vehicles for cakes. And on the opposite, I selected a German web store for furniture, search for the same word, and the search results only consist of kitchen scales. So what's the problem? As you can see, in German, both words are very similar. In fact, if you only look on the first part, Küchen, the translation to English is kitchens. And the first step in Solr when you index a word is a mapping of characters gets applied. It's a kind of normalization, though, that you get rid of all the strange characters you don't know in your language. And the pre-configured state is to turn the umlaut into a regular or normal character U. And that changes the meaning of the word completely. If you swap this character, then you get Kuchen, and Kuchen means cake. And that explains, if I go back, the different search result here on this page. This is just a simple example. If you look into details of full text searching, there are a lot of more language specific configurations. For example, stop words. There are words in different languages or exist in different languages but have completely different meanings. And in one language it's a stop word, in another it's not a stop word. The algorithms for stemming, for example, to get the same search results for singular and plural forms is completely different. The same is for protected words that should not be stemmed. An example from German, from the German language and some others, as compound word splitting. In Germany, we have very long words where you can attach different nouns to each other. And all of this needs to be configured per language. And if you don't do that, if you just take the index configuration out of the box, you will immediately run into situations where you get strange search results. The solution for this is or Solr already provides a lot of functionality to deal with multilingual content. And some years ago, I already implemented it for Drupal 7 and also Drupal 6. The module is named Apache Solr Multilingual. And now we ported it to Drupal 8 and changed its name. Now it's Search API Multilingual Solr Search. Without diving too deep into the technical details, the approach is that there's a configuration, there's a text field type where all the keywords or the content will be indexed in. And this one is configured. And if you just take the Solr Search backend, this is pre-configured for English. What we do with the multilingual backend is that we provide configurations for different languages as well. And not only languages, as you can see, for example, here is a text field DE, which is for German, and there's a text field DEAT, which means German for Austria. I think it's okay. Oh, okay. I continue while you try to fix that. and how does it work? There's a kind of index routing. This multilingual backend hooks in whenever something is stored in the index. And according to the language or the translation of an entity that is currently indexed, the fields get routed into the right or probably configured language-specific Solr fields. And the same or similar happens when you query the index. The queries that will be created by Search API got or are limited to specific languages. For example, the current language of the website or a language you select from a facet or a filter. And then the right language-specific fields get queried. Another fundamental change in Drupal 8 was the introduction of YAML files to store configurations and the creation of configuration entities to represent that configuration. And we leveraged this. We completely changed the architecture, and every Solr field is now represented as a configuration entity and therefore exportable. And instead of dealing with XML files, potentially nobody understands, we now have the base to offer user interfaces to adjust the changes or to adjust the search index to your needs. And we have a serializer that creates the XML that is valid, which you can simply put on your server. And you don't have to dive too much into the details. And what the serializer also is able to do is to serialize this configuration as JSON. And this is a new for a new feature in Solr. Solr introduced a managed schema that is somehow similar to Elasticsearch, which means if you change, for example, a stop word, you add or remove a stop word, you can immediately push it to your server and it gets applied. And you don't need to restart anymore or deploy your configuration. I don't recommend this at the moment to on a production server. We are still in alpha with all of this module, so it's complicated on production. But also the managed schemas in Solr itself has some issues. Not all filters are support the managed schema approach at the moment. Okay, let's do a little demo of how to work with the Solr server. This demo is about the configuration that will be created for you that you can, in a classic schema situation, deploy on your server. I hope you can read it. It's a pure Drupal installation. I create or I activated two languages, English and German. And if you go to Search API and add a server, once you install the multilingual module, you can create the server and select multilingual Solr as your backend. Once it is created, you immediately get, it's auto-detected that this is 5.4, and you get a download button to get the complete configuration you can use or put on your server. We also created an integration for Drush, which is potentially easier to use in an automated setup. And with this search API Solr multilingual generate configuration command, I now get a zip file for the server. And let's have a look into the file. As you can see, we have accent files for different languages, German and English. And if you search for the U umlaut here, then you see that it's no longer converted into simple U's, but in a U and an E. And that solves the problem in the search we saw before. There's also something for undefined languages. And it also generates these list of nouns which are required for the compound word filter. Two files regarding the additional field types. As you can see here, we have a lot of not that readable XML that gets generated, but which is probably pre-configured for English, German, and pre-configuration for language of an undefined content of an undefined language, which doesn't break the search results that much as the English filter would do. And based on these types, we create some additional fields. To understand this, you already need some more knowledge about how Solr works. But as I stated, the module already prepares everything for you. The same is true for stop words. As you can see here, we have a German stop word list pre-prepared, an English one. And these are taken from examples you find you find in the Solr project. And if I now enable an additional language, I wasn't that quick by clicking. I selected Dutch here. Then everything you have to do is just generate the new config files. Again, we are talking about the classic schema here, not the managed one. So we cannot, for the managed one, this step will be obsolete. But we have to wait until all filters are supported. And now we see there's an accent file for Dutch, the same for the nouns. And again, this is a complete config folder which includes all information just to get started. And as you can see on the top, the configuration for Dutch has been added. And the others are still in place. Okay. Okay, and the same is for the dynamic fields which are required. There are two new for the text fields, and also for the synonyms. Nick, are these true Dutch words? Yeah. Okay, so it works. Okay. No, I did something else. What you can also do is, if you want to upgrade your Solr server, you can upfront generate a new configuration, or if you have to downgrade it because your service provider has a different version. Now I create a version for a different targeted Solar version. As you remember, this example has been recorded with Solar 5. If we have a look now at the text files that have been created, you will notice that there's a 4.5.0 above. And within the XML, so there are a lot of changes because 4.5 doesn't support newer advanced filters that are available with starting with Solar 5. The next steps in the development might be the user interface for this. I also recorded just a little demonstration. What's currently in the user interface is somehow potentially confusing, but in the regular config export, you will find all the Solar fields. And so we can have a quick look on them. Took me a while to select one. And what you find here is the complete configuration. For example, something specific for German, the configuration of the stop word filter factory uses just stop words that are really German words. And the stemma factory, in this case, this for the snowball algorithm, also is configured for the German language. In the same configuration, you will find all the stop words and all other additional word lists that are required. So synonyms, nouns, there are plenty of them. The accents for a character encoding I already talked about. So this represents how the data is stored within Drupal, and which is also deployable. If you look at the entity, that config entity that takes or stores this information. This is just a quick and dirty user interface. It's not final now. You see the serializer, who converts it in XML and in JSON, and all of the text files, and and the JSON, for example, this is the required structure that needs to be sent via the REST API to a managed schema server. And what we can do here is edit these files, save them, but again, this doesn't look nice. And there's one interesting feature. If I have a running Solar server, I can export any configuration that exists there and simply paste it here, and it gets converted in a configuration entity in Drupal. But again, that's just the starting point. The data is there. You can use a text editor to edit it, or this very boring looking user interface. But that's that will be the next steps to do. And something I will ask for is we need help. We need help from people who speak different languages. My knowledge of languages is limited, and I think there are people already experienced with the Solar and their own language, and they are tweaked the index for their own language, provide this information. We will add this to the project so that we have more and more default configurations so that people simply can add their language and everything is already in place. And the same is true for the user interface. I think we can, or people can help there without having too deep knowledge about Solar and the potential problems there. But if you want to provide patches, we are working continuously during the dev days in the sprint room. And you're welcome to join. So, yeah, that's the end. Thanks again to the sponsors who gave us the possibility to meet here. And now it's time for questions. Yeah? Yeah, I think it's better for you to answer this.
Yeah. So, if I understood it correctly, you're asking what we did with the user interface when we merged the two Drupal 7 modules into one?
Just one.
Oh, okay. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So, what we did is we took a look at like what are the most used features in both modules and like how that UI looked like. For example, as I said, Apache Solr started with like a whole set of same defaults, so you could just enable it and start. That is something that we ported over to Search API. It's a separate module. It's called Search API Defaults. If you enable the two of them, you have actually a working search with the same search page, et cetera, live in Drupal 8. So we preferred the admin UI of Search API because it did allow for much more customization. As that wasn't a key feature of Apache Solr. So that's more or less how we made that decision. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah.
Any other questions? So from now on, you're going to make the best search for your Italian customer?
OK, anything else we can answer? Anyone who offers to provide the Italian default configuration? Okay. So we are done.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.